Okay, I think we're going to start. Yeah? Okay, small group, but anyhow, we'll make a good discussion, maybe. Welcome. First, I will introduce myself. My name is Marianne Bevelander. I'm working for the Dutch Ministry of Environment and Infrastructure. And I'm responsible for the implementation of INSPIRE there. And that's also why I have to make an apology to you, because I will do the first part of the presentation, and that's mainly about the legal aspects of the presentation. So that's why I'm going to read it to you, because I'm not familiar with all these legal terms. And when I end my first part, it will only take a few minutes, then Sandra van Wijngaarden and Theo Overduin of Junovum will take over. Yeah, and then they will more or less, Theo will explain the use cases of INSPIRE empowering our new Environmental Planning Act, and Sandra will tell you something about how we make a digital infrastructure with INSPIRE. So, in this workshop, we want to present and discuss with you how INSPIRE supports a major development in the area of authorization of activities concerning the physical environment in the Netherlands. This Environmental Planning Act will replace 15 existing acts of parliament. Even kijken, ja, even toe. So it's a bill which aims to renew the regulation of human activities with an effect on the physical environment. There is why an Environmental Planning Act? I will start by giving you the official answer. The purpose of the Environmental Planning Act is twofold. With an ambition regarding sustainable development, it sets out a coherent approach to achieve and maintain a safe and healthy physical environment and a good environmental quality. So this is a very quality answer. Very official answer. Secondly, it enables the efficient management, use and development of the physical environment for social purposes. So this is the aim at a high level. And but more easy to understand probably, there is a very practical reason, and this image is telling more than 1,000 words could do. We want to shorten the authorization procedures for permits, so people don't have to wait too long to realize their plans. This image shows the difficulty people working for governmental organizations are having in interpreting all kinds of laws and the time it takes to get a final decision. So there, people who want to have a building permit, they have to wait a long time at the moment. So it's too difficult to oversee all the regulations, etc. So this one environmental act will make procedures shortener. Short. Well, next slide. This bill, the Environmental Planning Act, will entirely or partially replace about 15 existing acts of parliament and also incorporate the area-based components of 8 other acts. In future, at least 10 other acts may be incorporated too into this new act by legislative amendments, including components concerning general environmental policy, for instance on hazardous substances and products. So it's all kinds of laws who are merged into one. In addition, after parliamentary parliamentary proceedings on the Nature Conservancy Act have been completed, it too will be incorporated into the EPA in its entirety. This total, it's not only at the moment that we will merge these acts, but there will be more in future. All planning and decision making concerning the physical environment will ultimately be regulated by one single act with a single set of six uniform core instruments. And Theo will explain about these instruments in his presentation. And this act will remove the divisions between existing laws and prescribe in a systematic way what needs to be regulated by Act of Parliament and what by order in Council. And besides this, it will offer a uniform terminology. So all kinds of different terms describing the same thing, but in different context. We will merge all this also and only have one vocabulary. So, next slide is the Planning Act and EU legislation. One of the principles in drafting the Act was to align it with EU legislation. The new Act legislation implements or re-implements the Netherlands' obligations under these EU directives. These obligations have in no way been compromised. Where possible, the Act uses EU terms and definitions. So in the during the years there were more new EU acts, so now we also merge these terms and definitions also in this our new Act. An analysis of EU directives revealed a number of recurring elements or building blocks, though they are not all found in every directive. These elements are now part of a policy cycle that underlies the structure of the Act. So, as you can see here, the building blocks. And then this is my last slide. This in drafting the Environmental Planning Act, the following principles have been applied. Maintaining existing levels of protection, development-driven and integrated approach, so not all these separated laws. More closely in line with EU legislation, the system's working methods will be closely aligned with the EU directives and based on existing division of responsibilities of governmental authorities. And last but not least, trust in government, because procedures were too long and trust was getting diminished, so we have to build this again. Well, you can understand this all requires a very good digital support because it won't work otherwise. So that's the moment when I will pass this thing to Sandra. Maybe you have some questions for me? Well, we will... after our presentation, we will make room to discuss this. So there will be time. Yeah?
Okay, I'm not really used to this thing, but it will work. Well, my name is Sandra van Wijngaarden. I'm the program manager for the implementation of Inspire in the Netherlands, working at Geonovum, and I'm going to tell you what is the link between Inspire and the story of Marjan about the Environmental Planning Act. Maybe you think, oh, I don't understand this, but I'm going to tell you. First to start with, you all know, of course, that Inspire is an infrastructure which delivers a lot of spatial data about environmental teams. I think it's a very nice picture, so I put it in the presentation, but differing from more general themes like roads, cadastral parcels, etc., to the themes which are more directly related to the environment. When we started with Inspire, of course, the data specification are based on use cases, but the most important drive to really implement the data for the first deadlines was more a supply orientation. You have to meet the demands of the deadlines. So what you see now, you also probably know the roadmap. Last December, it was the last deadline where the data sets as is are put in the infrastructure. So we had the deadlines for Annex 1, 2 and 3, and now the whole scope is in some way put in the infrastructure, but it's still from a supply point of view. But of course, the harmonization still has to come, but the data sets which are made available now are the most appropriate to fulfill the more the national demands. This is a picture. There is an infrastructure with Inspire, with the key registers. We have grown a garden, and now we carefully tend it. But if there really is, if there is no public in the garden, nobody visits the garden. There's not really a need to garden it anymore. So it will die. All the plants will die. So 2 years ago, with the Inspire steering committee in the Netherlands, we had a vision traject where traject where the idea was: okay, now that the first data sets are implemented, we need to look for the demand. What are the users? What are the use cases? And we decided in the Netherlands, the legal aspects Marianne has told about, you can see it as a sort of super use case for Inspire. Of course, the Environmental Planning Act has to do with the living environment, so it's very close to Inspire, and now we want to see, okay, how can you use the Inspire infrastructure? What can you use it for? Of course, Inspire is only one small part of the total geo infrastructure in the Netherlands. We have a big program in the Netherlands. It's called GOL. It's a Dutch abbreviation. It's difficult to say the exact words, but I think the sign GOL, it is specifically at, it's a very big infrastructural project, and there's really a drive also from the government to really realize there the information position of Inspire, but also of all the other data, geographical data, but also other data which is necessary for the Environmental Planning Act. So I think this is rather unique, because the legal part is very, very big in the history of legalization in the Netherlands, but there's also the infrastructure part of it. So it's named GOL. GOL has four integrated aspects. Of course, the law is the most important and the driver behind it. There's also a part which has to do with governance and financing, architecture and ICT, and the information, houses, I don't know how exactly. I have to explain this in English, but you will see later. There is something, it's a metaphor which is called the lane of the living environment. It's something like this. You have a road, and when you are a user, you go to that road and you get the information out of all the different houses. It's more or less that the domains are organized there, but it's centrally organized and they are connected to that lane. Maybe you ask, why a metaphor? It's not concrete. I agree with you. But this is a way to get the policymakers involved. And it's very important that the policymakers also have an idea about ICT, about information. And you see what happens here is everybody is talking about this metaphor. For example, there is a house, but there is also a front door, there is a backyard. You can think about it yourself, but this is a metaphor to get the policymakers really involved in the topic of information. When you look at this metaphor a bit more close, I don't have a sign and I'm too short, but you see there in the middle all the information houses. And the lane is here. It's in the lane there, it's the infrastructure, of course, and the standards and all the different information elements which are general. And for example, Inspire, we see it also as a part of that lane, more for the general information. So it starts, in fact, it starts here. When a citizen or a public organization wants to ask a permit for something to do in the living environment, it enters one place where it gets all the information. And the idea is also that all the information is gathered so that the people has sort of a preview if the permit will be admitted. So it's not you have an application and then you wait for a long period, but the process of information gives more information in an earlier stage. That's also an idea behind this. Here are the key registers and the more general elements, the information houses. And well, maybe you already see a relation between the Inspire themes and the domains in the houses. Also interesting, of course, is that there's a connection with the open data strategy and implementation project, and also a connection with a roundabout to other e-government programs. So there's a lane for the living environment, but there are also other lanes. Of course, this is a concept. When you look at Inspire and what's the meaning of Inspire related to the lane of the living environment, I usually use this picture to stress the three different aspects of Inspire. Of course, on the left-hand side, we have the data. It all has to do about the data. But Inspire is more than only data. It is made available with standards, with different standards. So it's you can also see Inspire as a method to make the data available, more like the infrastructure, etc. The other part is the organizational part. At least in the Netherlands, we do a lot of effort to decide what data sets are within what teams, to make decisions there, to involve people. People are organized in working groups around the theme. So next to the data, the infrastructure, there's also more the organizational part of Inspire. And when you look at the metaphor of the lane of the living environment again, the infrastructure, it's more here. And the part of the data is more in the information houses. And also more the organizational aspects is the method of deciding what data belongs to which information house. When we look at the data again, I already told about a citizen or a private organization who wants to apply for a permit. He first has the idea is that if he can orient himself, especially what is possible where, and in the where there's of course the geo aspect, then a lot of time is saved. To give you just a slight idea, area management, there are the data sets which helps the citizens to decide who is allowed to do what where. Of course, course, there are other data sets, but there's a clear link to area management theme. Another example is the species distribution. If you have insight in that information, you can see right in an early stage, for example, what extra additional measures must be taken before you ask for a permit. Of course, another example, the reference data is also important for modeling. It's not only the data and the processes, but there's a lot of modeling in between models which are built where the Inspire more general basic data can help there. So, well, that's the good news, that Inspire can play an important role in the metaphor of the lane of the living environment and help the information basis of the Environmental Planning Act. But there's also bad news, at least in the Netherlands. For example, if you look at the data which is made available now, it's not 100% fit for purpose. We have a lot of things to do before the Inspire data really can be used in a helpful way. For example, if you look at the data in one theme, it could be that there are 5 or 6 data providers in that theme. But the user, well, he's not really, he wants just one service where they are all connected together. Or maybe the same principle, not within one team, but over the themes. And he doesn't want to deal with, okay, what's the version of the data? How about the actuality? Does it fit together? It's especially for a citizen, he doesn't have geo information tools. He just wants an answer to a question. So the data itself, usually there has been 1 or 2 steps extra before you can use that data. Well, of course, you can talk about this subject in theory, but we thought it would be a better idea to use it in real practice and see what additional things the data provider should do to make the data really useful for their processes. And with this, we want to stimulate the users and the data providers to get together and organize the contact between them. So this is really going to work. And to do that, we thought, okay, we must really work with the data in real use cases, so we can have good examples and, well, also spread the word of Inspire to show with best practices that it's really worthwhile to use Inspire. So we have some concrete use cases, and my colleague is going to tell more about that.
Gaat er goed zo? I hope there is some sound. Thank you. We're getting more people over and over, so it pleases us very much. My name is Theo Overduin. I'm a colleague of Sandra van Wijngaarden at Unovum. And my specific role within the Inspire implementation program in the Netherlands is the development and stimulation of use cases. So the demand driven side gets also a phase in use cases that really show the benefits of Inspire. And within that, of course, it's logical we have a focus on finding use cases that are in the domain of the Environmental Planning Act, so that we can see there the first working practice and examples of the big ideas of this new act, making it all simpler and better for citizens and private companies who want to take an initiative on a certain location. So that's where we have started some time ago, and we didn't want it in kind of plans and dreams for the next years, but here and now we want these to create or find maybe already existing best practices that show the idea of what we want to reach with the idea of the lane and a simple legislation structure, so that people no longer have to wait very long on can I do this activity on this specific location. Okay, that's where we started. And then the first question was where to start, where can we expect the most added value, and where do we have the best chance in finding examples and showcases already in practice here and now. And of course, then we looked at the six core instruments that are in this new act, and they're here listed out, all six. There's something called an area vision, for a long term, for mostly a greater piece of land. It could be a complete municipality or a region. That's the first one. The second is an environmental plan. It's more concrete. It's most of the times it's on a specific location, and it has more legal power. So the elements in this environmental plan are more binding for citizens and private companies. The third one is an environmental permit. And there are throughout the Netherlands thousands of them processes each year. So we here talking of a big volume production. And there are general state regulations, decentralized rules, because one of the ideas of this new Environmental Planning Act is also that there is more playing room on a local level for the local administrations to come to real practical solutions and to deal and wheel on the spot to make things possible. And then finally, there's this instrument we call in the Netherlands the project decision. And we can't take them all, because we have limited resources and limited time, so we decided to focus on two of the six, which is already quite complicated. We took the environmental plan and the environmental permit, and mainly because there are so many plans and procedures going on. So here the chance is the biggest that there are applications to support these processes, and when we can manage to link those kind of applications to the data published by Inspire, for instance, then and it's working in that mainstream, then we really can put a very big step forward. So that was the idea. And we started with the environmental plan, of course. That's you see an example there in the right. And of course, to make such a plan, and I think in the Netherlands there are about 5,000 of these plans being made every year, there is some sort of information demand to make such a plan. And the same is for instance a building permit. So there's an information demand on that side, and of course there's information supply on this side, Inspire, we hope, brings a strategic part of the information supply, and the art is to bring this all together. And of course here you can also draw the lane in between that Sandra told us about. Okay. Well, we went to the companies that and the municipalities, the public organizations that make those environmental plans, and they were very glad we came around because they showed us, for instance, examples like this they already are working with. And you see here, this is one of the exercises for each environmental plan is always done. It's the inventorization of the plan area itself. What spatial functions are there already, and what is the starting situation of the plan. And they used to make these kinds of maps by going into the field on a bike with a great paper map, and it took some weeks, many days, to bring up to inventorize all the spatial functions. And of course it's a very nice job when it's nice weather and when you have plenty of time, but it's quite expensive also. And since Inspire is operational in the Netherlands, and also the key registers that are Inspire compliant, they make the same base map of the plan area just by one push on the button, and the reliability is also much higher. Of course, it's a pity the people don't have to go on the bike and go into in the field anymore, but it saves a lot of time and a lot of money. And this is already one of the examples where you can see that the idea of the new Environmental Planning Act and the digital support base and the lane of the living environment can really work. And this is only one example. With the same data, it's also possible already at the moment to do some three-dimensional modeling in the same way. So the inventorization in the plan area is not only the 2D static map, but also these kinds of 3D area model. And it already works in application with innovative firms that make the plans. And another example they already work with also is the noise modeling around roads. They use the same data and their existing models, and they can make a very easy analysis to show on what buildings extra measures must be taken for noise protection. This is no future, this is already operational. And also by using a lot of data that is available, a lot of data also and services that are that wouldn't be available when there was no Inspire program, you can do things like this and make a spatial analysis in a region to find out where what are the best places for new windmills. And then it's not only the idea of course, using the data, but you also want to have some idea from about what the benefits really are. And this is just a simple calculation on the environmental plans in the Netherlands. So I told you already, we make about 5,000 of these plans each year. The total cost per plan are about €20,000, and it is estimated that because of the use and the reuse of Inspire data and services, you can save about 10% of the cost of making this plan. And then it's a simple calculation that for only this kind of job in the Netherlands, we can save 10 million euros per year. Oh, it's maybe not a very big amount, but I think it's quite significant anyway. And besides saving money, it's also important that the waiting time for citizens and private companies can be reduced by at least 20%, because we all use in the whole chain the same data based on the same definition with the same so even when you have to go to court when there is a disagree about anything, the calculation of noise or whatever, when you all use the same data and it's legally based, there are a lot less procedures also. So it brings better service for citizens and private companies. So our advice is simple, just do it. The second use case we are working on, it's not finished yet, is the environmental permit, and specific for this core instrument of the Environmental Planning Act is the situation of chain cooperation. Before this permit is admitted, there are a lot of public organizations who all have to look at some aspect of this permit. So there is a municipality, or maybe sometimes two or three municipalities, depending on the location of the permit, and there is most of the times also a water board involved. There is a province involved, and even when it's a complicated demand, the national government also has to do a part of the permit process. So what we do is inventorize at the moment what all these different organizations do within the same chain, what information they use at the moment. Do they all use the same, or do they use different kind of base information? The third question is, do they already make use of Inspire data and services? Do they even know it exists? So that's a very interesting question we are finding out at the moment. And last but not least, we bring them all together and we ask them from how would the ideal future look like if we try to work together in a more efficient and better way to take care of environmental permits. And within 1 or 2 months, this pilot will also be finished, and first results are, and the enthusiasm of the involved parties gives us a very good hope that this will also bring new ideas on how we can improve the way we are working and we use data together. Next to the two use cases we are working on, and Sandra already mentioned it, we also like to promote what we call the Inspire method. Sandra already pointed out that all the data that is needed for the new Environmental Planning Act is not really one-to-one compliant with the data that is available at the moment, and not also one-to-one compliant to what is under Inspire. So there are a lot of spatial data which are at the moment not Inspire compliant, And we started thinking about maybe we should add on the three annexes for Europe, a fourth annex for ourselves in the Netherlands, and use the Inspire approach to do the same we already are working on with Annex 1, 2 and 3, but make it do the same for the other data to bring it on the same level and use the Inspire approach to get all the data on the same level of availability, quality, reliability as we are working on for the Inspire compliant data already. That's the idea, and we hope that that idea is also adopted by the Ministry of Environment and Infrastructure, so that it can help to bring to realize the digital information basis in a faster and better way, and to take advantage of all the experience we already are building up in within the Inspire context. So we promote Inspire also for a national extra activity, and hope that when this works, even in courtrooms, I already said when there is a dispute, that we have a lot of less conflicts that will be fought out in a courtroom anyway. And it takes also it's gonna take a lot of savings in time and conflicts and money anyway. Besides the two examples of use case I presented, we already have a first set of other use cases that are maybe not linked to the Environmental Planning Act, but we are proud of them anyway. So I'd like to to promote this web page at the Geonovum website, and although we are working on a better presentation than this one, it's only in Dutch and you have to click on all the examples. We yesterday saw a very nice example of how they present use cases for citizens and private companies in a very simple way here in Denmark. So we like to copy that the way they do that and make this a better page within maybe 1 month, 2 months or so. Well, that ends up our presentation part. And maybe there are some questions before we start the interactive part of this workshop.
This Annex 4 thing is the thing that you mentioned.
Okay.
Annex 4 is the data that are not yet available, physically, and are not yet available in the internet. Do you have examples of typical data that are needed in this that are not in Inspire data specifications? And the situation is that you have, that you need more detailed information. I think Inspire has a lot of data specifications and data sets, but they're not always that detailed. So you want to extend on Inspire specifications.
Okay. Now, simply for extending the data models, because there is more detailed need for information, you don't need an Annex 4, but you can, in the Annex 3 and 2 and 1 implementation, there's already the possibility to go beyond, I think. But I see my colleague, okay, so that's one. But the Annex 4 item, there is no worked out agenda of the themes that could be under such an additional program. But when now we can work on it, there is still time before this new act is in function within 3 or 4 years. So there is plenty of time to bring up such an Annex 4 if it's necessary. I think a lot of current data providers are not happy with it because they already are fully loaded to meet the challenges and deadlines already. Sandra, you?
So correct what you think.
Okay. An answer to your question, Paul. Maybe other questions? Actuality, of course, yes. Yes, that's, I think that's quite a challenge but we also have the situation at the moment that in the original source data there is more actuality. Some key registers are refreshed every day, every half an hour. And that's far beyond what Inspire asks, for instance. So then you have the situation, how can we, how do you say that, how can we keep the high quality we already have and maintain that also when Inspire doesn't need that high level. And the other situation is also possible that the data specifications require that you have to refresh it every year or every 2 year or every 4 year. But for local planning, you need more actual information. Then you have to go back to the data providers and negotiate if they are willing to bring it on the needed level and what effort it takes and how they are financed and so. So that's also the part where I saw that was in your part of the presentation, the governance and finance part of this whole program is going on. Yes.
Then you go back to the data providers, the local data providers, ask maybe for more precise data or more actual data.
Yeah, the data providers in discussions.
We are still at the beginning of the process of bringing the information demand and supply together in a better way, and I think we are discovering very much in the next period or 1 or 2 years. Who gets the costs and who gets the benefits, of course. And okay, Hugo.
So very sound Dutch thinking, of course. I would very much appreciate that you would have some about it. What I was wondering about is that maybe beautiful policy now. And suddenly, the Environmental Planning Act, the planning environment, planning permits and so on, are typically a governmental response to a problem. Now, I was wondering if you set up a beautiful station framework of acts, permits, and programs, if you could also apply that to the degree of compliance with existing Dutch legislation with regard to, for example, noise limits. You mentioned noise as well.
Mm-hmm.
Bring up these kind of visual representation mapping of where locally, regionally, the environment is in compliance with existing legislation or not. That would be a very powerful communication tool with local governments and with stakeholders in the public.
That's exactly the idea, that you have a clear view of what's possible where. Early stage in the process. That's exactly the idea.
So you are really going to bring up also this, say, degree of compliance here within.
Yes.
That's
yeah, that goes beyond the data. So you also have to bring in business rules and decision schemes. And it's when that's all available and the lane is the lane of the living environment is operational, we hope that it gives people and private companies who want to take an initiative, gives them much more tools to make their own decisions. And they get an on the fly a first insight in if I want to make to settle my my plant on this location. Do I have a chance or is it impossible from the first moment? And otherwise you can if the conclusion is forget to bring this initiative to this location, tell me what are the locations where I can bring it anyway. And okay, not here, but where then else in the region? And we hope that it makes it possible within a few years that citizens and companies who are asking for a permit, they never get the answer no. So they always get the answer, no, you can do it on this location, but you can go there. And that's an answer the governments working together in change, they can't bring up now.
It's more than 2 years, I think.
Ah, we're always...
desired methods, as you say, and looking at your slide where you put the data and information on those houses that are more or less following the themes of Inspire and so. Having this type of approach, so using Inspire methods as common, let's say, tool in the country for rooting in the environment and not only, it's not possible to stay tight with what is the core, what is in the regulation, nothing more. So I wonder how we can explain what is this approach. If it is different from the one I said going into the minimalist approach, mm-hmm. in a way that other member states can learn from that, what is the difference of having a vision that brings benefits in the medium term for some, long term for others, but anyhow, it's already with, let's say, use cases behind that for which we are sure we get benefits. So is it also part of this annex 4, or is it something you called in a different way, or does it mean that you want to have the old data sets, let's say, currently used that you are transforming into Inspire? Do you use all you have, independently from getting the old within the system or not? Do you use all data you have regarding certain data sets to be kind of Inspire compliant, to be made available to the service and so on? Or do you select somehow from what exists already, what is going to be transferred, and pull something else to the other objects that are not part of the minimal approach?
Look for the use cases, because you can talk about the benefits of Inspire, but if there are really no data sets at all, nobody will believe you. We have the idea that they really have to see the advantages, and not only because we say so, but also because they really see it in their own work. And if you have something which is done 5,000 times, okay, then there's some load. But we also started with the core data sets, and now we're trying to do more. But Inspire is not a movement on its own, of course. The way of making data available through web services and with a higher performance, it's also a kind of movement in itself. So we don't always stress Inspire as a method. It's more of coupling it to other programs, but yeah, not with a big bang, but with steps, and starting with only the core, maybe then the extensions, and then something extra. But I think showing the real benefits, and also with the money, it will help, and you can use that use case by spreading the word and pressing the benefits. But we are trying. We don't know the solution.
Okay. One final question, and then we would like to challenge you to the interactive part.
Thanks very much. There will be a lot of very valuable use cases here. I think that they are probably applicable in many countries, maybe just in different fields or something. But I was wondering, can you explain, do you already use any data platforms to, let's say, data on the Inspire for this model?
I don't exactly understand your question. Do you use the data which is already transformed to the Inspire models?
Yeah.
No, we usually use the data as is at the moment, so it's not transformed yet. But it is made available within the Inspire framework. So yes, it's Inspire, but it's not Inspire, which is compliant to the Inspire data models.
Sometimes. It's not harmonized.
Sometimes, but not very much. We are a bit slow in the Netherlands with the transformation to the Inspire data models. Well, maybe just like the other countries, I don't know exactly, but for such a national law, the more the national data are more important because they have more detail than the data specifications of Inspire.
In the use cases we have seen, and also the other ones that are on our website, you see a mixture. Some applications, for instance in the smart city concept, already use the Inspire services, because the companies that develop those apps want to use them in different countries. And the other situation, when the original data source as is used, is also we also see that in practice.
But do you plan to when Inspire data will be when data will be provided in Inspire conformant way, do you plan to change the data flow for these cases in the application? Or do you then, because it will probably bring some additional cost, or will you provide the Inspire compliant data in addition to your already established normal applications which you use in your government system?
Yeah, we're more or less in the middle of that discussion now in the Netherlands. So I don't know the exact answer. I think there will be two data sets, one which is transformed and one which is more like as it is now, which can be applied for national use cases. But we're in the middle of that discussion, so we're not there yet.
Maybe next year on the next Inspire conference we can tell more about that. Okay, no other burning questions. Then the last part. We originally thought the whole audience was filled, so we made three subgroups, but we have changed our plan. Now we take a short time, and we would like to ask the whole audience to go first for about 5 or 10 minutes to Marianne in that corner, and reflect on the first question. Are there similar developments in other countries? Maybe a few minutes is enough, and then we go to the here with our virtual flip over on the school board, and go to the second question where Sandra is available, and we can discuss that. And then, of course, we have the last 5 minutes or 10 minutes. You all come to me on this part. And we'd like to go a bit more in detail about the use cases. Are there tips and tricks we can benefit on the work we are doing? Or maybe you have some other brilliant ideas. And then...
we don't need to do plan on
we don't
anymore,
need
I think.
Because it's 3:30 and we all want to go out, so we collect the results and take advantage of it. Okay, so may I invite you to go to Marianne and reflect on
yes,
whether there are comparable developments in other countries.
Thank you. Thank you. It was a hard job because they started, I think, 50 years ago.
Yeah.
It was a program. In the first instance, they would rely on the municipalities to do the voluntary. They didn't do anything, so they made it into a law to make the digital, their plans digital, and publish them as well.
Yeah,
they're
only digital at the moment that
the
new plan is made. So
yeah,
there's
a transition.
We have an application for the
and the state.
still 5 minutes left.
Okay.
For the other two questions, so I think we don't move over Denmark. I just have some room here, and maybe which is the most triggering question left? Tips and tricks for our use cases for the lame of the environment.
Yeah.
Other ideas about use cases? We could take a public show.
It's based on monument preservation. And that's again under state jurisdiction in Germany. So the terminology is different from state to state. Mm-hmm. And so they use bioprotected sites schema and expanded that. And in doing so, they formed a group of from representatives from each state, and they discussed their own terminology and made a German code list for monuments. And that was triggered by the Inspire process, and that also helps to get more of the original data into the Inspire data model and conform it. But that's one example. And so Peter wants to come back to your question, what do we do once we have transformed into the Inspire data model?
Yeah.
What do we do with the leftovers?
Yeah.
And we have discussed that a lot recently in Germany, and we got a very clear legal answer saying, when you have transformed to the Inspire schema, the leftovers, if you will, if there's still something in there which falls under Article 4 of the directive, mm-hmm. you still have to provide it somehow. And then we said it doesn't make sense to have a leftover download service or something. So we said at least in Bavaria that we will, even after the date of the provision of Inspire compliant data, we will still run all the services also with the original data model. This is a considerable effort, of course.
Mm-hmm.
Because it costs a lot to host services, we have to pay our provider for that, for each service, and so, but we would, at least the way we said we would, most of the data we will do that, because there's still use cases and business processes built on the original data models, so.
I agree, because the data isn't there for no reason.
Yeah. But not all data providers are ready to providers. We've looked into that, but there's a lot of, as always, a lot of administrative issues? I mean, who is the provider? Who is responsible? Who there are different, different states. I mean, one is old, one is, what do you put in metadata? Things like that, as the date of the last revision. So it's the tiny things which are really difficult in doing so. It would be nice for some parts, but I guess in the end, everybody would fill the part of the inspired specification with their data they have, and then we have several services for one theme. But for the particular monuments, then now we get monuments data from the monument administration in the current format, and later he will get it in the inspired format being this added code list. And
already implemented, you mean? I mean, already implemented is difficult to have a lot because NX 2 and 3 are, they are very recent.
Yeah.
Unless people are using previous versions, whatever, of data spec and so. But, so, I it's normal that for a while, probably a long while, it depends, we'll have this situation where we have both. The issue I found when I tried to discuss these issues of when getting Inspire compliant to a team so-and-so, if your service doesn't, let's say, is not owner of all that, all of the data sets that have all the elements, are you integrating your gaps with the data coming from another institution? People don't want to talk about this. And the problem, and the other way around, I have my data sets with a lot of more data than what is requested. Don't talk to transform this. I even put there a filter to be sure that we don't touch those things because it's not in the law. And I think this here is not that they, it's not a question of doubting the obligation to share the data as is at that moment. The issue is on using the opportunity to transform whole since they are doing the exercise, and the vision that is behind, if behind there is a business model that permit me to have a different type of service which I can use, saying that it's not legal, it's not mandated by law, so I can do this, or if it's a lack of vision, or if it's at a certain point also cost, but without evaluating how much is the cost involved, comparing do the transformation once for all and then reuse for all use cases you may need now or in future, or do every time people ask me the data just for what is on the regulation and use the others for my own, let's say, business with the format I used to do before. So since without making a clear comparison what is the cost involved in one and another situation, we cannot even argue that it's a question of cost.
Yeah.
It may be a question of priorities if the vision is to do all the exercise in future.
Thank you very much for being here and discussing with us about all the things we are working on. Future cooperation and the use of knowledge and experience.
We hebben toch nog een ronde te gaan?
Ja, precies.
Ja. Ja, leuk toch?
Ja.
Ja. Fijn dat onze Nederlandse vrienden er waren.
Ja, maar er zaten best wel boeiende IRC-mensen in die zaal hoor.
Ja, zeker. Ja. Ja, zeker, ja.
Ze snappen het ook.
Ja, ze snappen het ook.
Heel fijn. Hey, Groen. Hoe is het?
Welkom in Denemarken.
Net onze presentatie gemist.
Nee, ik heb net Pittik helemaal niet link op de data
ingedrukt. Oh, nee. Okay. Yep. So, and the VNO, some of the planning is performed by the other ministers.
Yeah,
so, just the planning on their own.